In this clip, we'll discuss the effect of Pleistocene rewilding on climate change. The end of the last ice age, also known as the late Pleistocene, lasted from 130,000 BCE to 8,000 BCE. During this time, animals like on these pictures roamed the lands. However, when the last ice age ended and the climates changed, ecosystems in turn got altered, and so did we see the end of many of these animals.
Pleistocene rewilding plans aim to bring these ecosystems back. These plans require carefully managed ecosystem manipulations using closely related species, like elephants, and have two general phases. We will discuss these plans using two existing movements. We will also explain the climate and ecological benefits. Now I'll talk about phase one using Zimov. Zimov's plans to bring back the grassland-rich mammoth steppe ecosystem. It used to cover most of Eurasia, but together with the mammoth, started to disappear once humans moved further into northeastern Siberia and the major ice sheets started to disappear. Current Arctic grasslands are outcompeted by mosses, shrubs, and large trees, unless big herbivores are present. Big herbivores help the mammoth steppe stay intact by damaging these competing plants, harvesting grass litter, and fertilizing the soil, leading to conditions that favor grass. According to Zimov, the declining abundance of these herbivores due to the efficient human hunting meant the grassland slowly got outcompeted by the tundra ecosystem, which in turn had a negative feedback loop on the big herbivores as these lost their main food source. By reintroducing and managing big herbivores into the tundra climate, they can convert it back to the mammoth steppe. Multiple small-scale studies have already succeeded in this and have shown that this change has major benefits to help fight global warming. Permafrost carbon preservation. Due to climate warming, permafrost in the soil is starting to melt. When this permafrost melts, it will release greenhouse gases like CO2 and methane into the atmosphere, leading to a vicious cycle. During winter, these big herbivores will press down the snow, destroying the heat-insulating layer, causing the ground to be colder, which in turn lowers the rate at which permafrost falls. Carbon sequestration. Grasses are able to sequester a large amount of carbon in their root systems. We are unsure if they do it better than shrubs, but because of their large ground cover, they probably sequester more carbon overall. Albedo effect. Since grasslands tend to be lighter in color than the tundra ecosystem, it reflects more light back into space. Since the ground does not absorb this heat, it can stay cooler, helping prevent the thawing of permafrost. Methane emission reduction. Grasses have high evapotranspiration and dry out the soil, which in turn leads to less methane emission from the ground.
Once the Pleistocene ecosystems are brought back and stable enough, we need to manage them. Donlan argues in a second phase for the reintroduction of top predators. These keystone species can infect entire food chains and therefore ecosystem structure and process. Populations regulated by predators are less vulnerable to climate change than populations regulated by climate controls, food availability, or direct climatic factors. Due to their ecological role, this means interactivity with other species, big predators like cheetahs and lions wouldn't only strengthen the ecosystem, but will also increase biodiversity. Prey populations in areas without a natural enemy may go through large boom and bust cycles, building on times of wealth, leading the population to quest when an area is grazed out or productivity changes. Reducing food availability and plant biodiversity, the Oostvaardersplassen is a good example of this. As we have learned from the Yellowstone National Park example, carnivores affect the behavior and demography of their prey. Wolfpacks were reintroduced by conservationists in the national park. Their prey species were more vulnerable in some open grasslands, so they stopped grazing there. More plants could develop and new trees could grow, attracting new species like birds and bears in preference to the pests and weeds that will otherwise dominate the landscape. Biodiversity can protect these landscapes from challenges that climate change can bring in the future and can make sure new created habitats can't easily collapse. A diverse range of fauna is more resilient against changes in the environment than a homogeneous one. This Pleistocene rewilding is quite a controversial idea that faces lots of challenges. The objections include the possibility of disease transmission, the fact that habitats have not remained static over millennia, and the likelihood of ecological and social consequences of reintroductions. However, it is interesting to think of our wildlands controlled by large mammals that used to live there. Can you picture it already?